Welcome to Understand the Math. In this video, I'll go over the inverse sine, inverse cosine, and inverse tangent functions. I'll explain their domain, range, graphs, and cancellation properties. We'll begin by going over three common inverse trigonometric functions. Inverse trigonometric functions are functions that undo the action of their corresponding trigonometric functions. They are used to find angles and to solve trigonometric equations. The three inverse trigonometric functions that arise most in applications are the inverse sine, or the arccsine function, the inverse cosine, or arccosine function, and then lastly, the inverse tangent, or the arctangent function. To find the domain, range, and graphs of these three inverse trigonometric functions, we need to restrict the domain of sine, cosine, and tangent so that they are one-to-one functions and then can have an inverse. We can set the sine function to be 1 to 1 from minus pi over 2 up to pi over 2. In this interval, the sine function takes on all the values from minus 1 to 1. We can set the cosine function to be 1 to 1 from 0 to pi. And in this interval, cosine takes on all the values from minus 1 to 1. In the same way, we can set the tangent function to be 1 to 1 in the interval between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. The tangent function then takes on all the values from minus infinity up to infinity. These two bullet points summarize what we've just been talking about. We've restricted the domain of all three of these functions to be intervals where they have all their values and are one to one. Let's now talk about the inverse sine or arccsine function. We'll begin with this sine function that has its domain restricted to be between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. So let's make a note that theta is going to range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, and then sine theta is going to take on the values between minus 1 and 1. We're now going to let sine theta be equal to x, and then theta is the arccsine of x, or we can write it as inverse sine of x. Let's make a note that the inverse sine of x is not 1 divided by the sine of x. Let's now go back to the sine function above and fill in values for each endpoint. This point is minus pi over 2, minus 1, and this point is pi over 2, comma 1. As sine theta goes from minus 1 to 1, x, which is equal to sine theta, will go from minus 1 to 1. When x goes from minus 1 to 1, theta is going to go from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2. So our graph is going to look like this. For our inverse sine function, we'll make a note that x ranges from minus 1 to 1, and our inverse sine x ranges from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2. We'll now look at the inverse cosine function or arccosine function. Let's make a note that theta is going to range from 0 to pi, and then cosine is going to range from minus 1 to 1. We'll let cosine theta be equal to x, and then theta is equal to arccosine x, or inverse cosine x. And just like sine, we'll make a note that this is not equal to 1 divided by cosine x. Let's put in our coordinates like we did for the sine graph. This point here is 0, 1, and this point is pi minus 1. As cosine theta goes from minus 1 to 1, x, which is equal to cosine theta, is going to go from minus 1 to 1. Our theta then is going to go from pi to 0, and we'll mark that in our graph. When it's negative 1, it's pi, and when it's 1, it's equal to 0. So our graph is going to look like this. Let's now make a note that for inverse cosine x, our x is going to range from minus 1 to 1, and our inverse cosine function is going to range from 0 all the way up to pi. Lastly, we'll look at our arctangent function. For our tangent function, let's make a note that our theta is going to range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. And then our tangent function takes on values between minus infinity and infinity. We'll let tangent theta be equal to x. And then theta is going to be arctan x or inverse tan x. And again, this is not equal to 1 divided by tangent x. As we range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, our inverse tangent function will range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. Our bottom asymptote is located at minus pi over 2, and our top asymptote is located at pi over 2. Our tangent function takes on values from minus infinity to infinity. That's as close as we can get to marking minus infinity to infinity. Our x will then range between minus infinity and infinity. So our inverse tangent function looks like that. This function's used a lot in applications. We'll make a note that our x value is going to range between minus infinity and infinity, and then our inverse tangent function is going to range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. We'll now talk about the properties of inverse trigonometric functions and look at the graphs of each of the three trig functions along with their inverses. We can say that inverse trigonometric functions undo the action of their corresponding trigonometric functions and vice versa. Just as a reminder, this can only happen for a predetermined interval or domain where the function is 1-to-1 and has an inverse. Here we have sine and inverse sine pictured together. Since the functions are inverses of each other, they're symmetric about the line y is equal to x. Our sine x is going to be defined between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, and our inverse sine x is defined between minus 1 and 1. When we look at the graph of cosine x and inverse cosine x, let's note that cosine x is defined for x between 0 and pi, and inverse cosine x is defined for x between minus 1 and 1. In a similar manner, the graph of our tangent function is defined for x between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, and inverse tan x is defined for x between minus infinity and infinity. We'll now summarize in this table what we just learned. Students often have to memorize these values. The restricted domain for our sine function is between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, and the range of our sine function is between minus 1 and 1. The domain for our inverse sine function is between minus 1 and 1, and our inverse sine function takes on the range between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. The cosine and tangent values look like this. We'll end by talking about inverse function properties. These are also called cancellation properties. Inverse sine of x is going to equal x where sine x is defined. We can see that sine x is going to be defined between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. So inverse sine of x is going to equal x when x ranges between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. Outside of this interval, it's not going to equal x. Similarly, sine of inverse sine of x is equal to x, where inverse sine of x is defined. And this happens when x ranges between minus 1 and 1. We can do the same type of analysis for cosine and tangent, and here's what we get. The biggest mistake I usually see students make with this is to use these cancellation properties in an interval where they're not defined. So you just have to be very careful and look at the interval. In the next video in this series, we'll talk about how to evaluate these inverse trigonometric functions. If this video has been helpful to you, please consider subscribing to my channel. Keep believing in yourself and have a great rest of your day.